Okay, let's begin while we continue letting folks in. Welcome. We're glad that you're here with us tonight as we continue to share nuggets, both large and small, about our brother in Christ, Mattie J.T. Stepanek. My name is Kathy Dempsey, and I am president of the Mattie J.T. Stepanek Guild. The mission of the Guild is to gather, organize, and share information and testimony of the life, virtues, writings, and ministry of Mattie, so that one day, God willing, we may be able to advance his cause of canonization in the Catholic Church. Mattie was born on July 17, 1990, and died on June 22, 2004, after living nearly 14 years with a rare form of muscular dystrophy. Mattie packed a lot into his nearly 14 years on Earth. As we heard last month in our first session of this virtual conversation series, Mattie was just a boy playing and joking, and yet he was so much more. Mattie had wisdom beyond his years and circumstances, and Mattie believed he received messages from God, which he embraced completely. I encourage everyone to visit our virtual conversations webpage to watch last month's video or to watch it again, and definitely to share it with others. We're dropping that link into the chat now. In addition to the two more online series that we have sessions in the series, we have two more major events as we remember Mattie in his 20th year. Please join us for Mattie's 20th anniversary Memorial Mass on June 22nd, Saturday at 10 a.m. at St. Rose of Lima Church in Gaithersburg, Maryland. If you live far away, that's okay because it will be live streamed. Please join our email mailing list to receive details as they become available, and the sign up for that is also being dropped in the chat. And I'm delighted to announce that we just added a fundraiser for the evening before the Mass on Friday, June 21st, from 7 to 9 p.m. at the Knights of Columbus Rosenstiel Hall in Silver Spring. We have some wonderful sponsorships available, and individual tickets are just $50 per person. Please check out the details on our special webpage, see the chat for the link, and we'll spend the evening reminiscing and celebrating Mattie. For this evening, we have left plenty of time for your questions and comments toward the end of the session. In the meantime, we ask that you put your questions in the chat. And of course, this session is being recorded and will be posted on our website, mattiematters.org, later this week. So before we begin, let us bring ourselves to the Lord in prayer. This excerpt, prayer titled Andre, My Brother, is from St. Joseph Oratory in Montreal. And St. Brother Andre Bessette was quite special to Mattie. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You knew how to pray in the midst of your tasks, in the quiet of the night, deep in your solitude, or surrounded by friends. Teach me the words that nourish my soul. You knew how to suffer, to hope in the future, without complaint, without fear, to stand firm, to face life. Teach me the meaning of suffering in silence. You knew how to live for the God whom you served, for his son, for his father, for his mother, to save what is lost, to free what is shackled. You teach me to hope in God and his universe. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. We thank in advance our four speakers tonight for sharing their stories and experiences and understandings. We will hear first from Jeni Stepanek, Mattie's mom, who continues his legacy of peacemaking with the Mattie J.T. Stepanek Foundation. A link to the foundation is being put in the chat. Dr. Jeni Stepanek is a memory curator, peace cultivator, beach chair philosopher, and mom to Katie, Stevie, Jamie, and Mattie Stepanek. After Jeni, we will hear from one of the Guild's directors, Cheryl Kerwin, who knew Mattie all of his life. Cheryl is a 33-year Air Force veteran and member of the Catholic Curcio movement. She lives in Prince George's County, Maryland, and attends St. Michael's Parish in Brandywine. Cheryl got to know Jeni at her previous parish, Mount Calvary in Forestville, when they attended adult education classes together. Cheryl attended both Mattie's baptism and his funeral mass. Johnny Tsai is the author of Pain of Grace, Living and Suffering with Dignity, which chronicles her life of grace, dealing with the chronic debilitating pain and deteriorating condition called Ehlers-Danlos. She is also the writer and illustrator of a poetry picture book, Cloud of Witnesses. Jeni earned her undergraduate degree in art education at the University of Maryland and a graduate degree in psychology from the Institute of Psychological Studies at Divine Mercy University. Jeni is the wife of Deacon Bob Tsai and the proud mother of four grown children, including Father Chris Tsai, and five amazing grandchildren. Jeni and Deacon Bob live in Bowie, Maryland, with their very spoiled Bichon Poo puppy, Samwise. A link to Johnny's beautiful book, Pain of Grace, is being dropped in the chat. It is life-giving. Father Chris Tsai grew up in Maryland and was ordained a priest of the Archdiocese of Washington in 2014. After serving at a parish a couple of years, he was sent to the Catholic University of America for further studies. Father Tsai currently serves as the Director of Spiritual Formation at St. John Paul II Seminary. Father Tsai recently wrote the book Rekindling Wonder, Touching Heaven in a Screen-Saturated World, all about our phones and screens and devices and our increasing spiritual apathy. Father Chris calls us to rekindle wonder. A link to his book is in our chat. And the Guild is very grateful to Father Scythe, who also serves as the Guild's spiritual advisor. Tonight, we share with you who was Mattie, who is Mattie, and we focus on a life of hope as a faithful servant. Jeni, welcome.
Thank you very much. Let me share my screen here. And I think we've got that there. All right, so welcome everybody. In the first of these four webinars, last month I shared my reflections on my son as a child, a young man who celebrated life with peace and with purpose and with play. Last month I shared what Mattie was like as a child, a typical kid with typical joys. I also shared some of his atypical challenges, disability and pain, losses of siblings and friends, financial burdens, bullying, and his passionate, and I mean passionate, concern for others. In this session this evening, the themes that we're generally exploring are faithful servant, hope, and gratitude. I'm going to be focusing mostly on the first of these themes. And I will begin by simply saying, in my humble opinion, my son, Mattie J.T. Stepanek, came into this world, lived in this world, and left this world ever, ever a faithful servant. I honestly do not remember a time, even when he was so very young and just learning to use language, I don't remember a time that Mattie was not intrigued by church, by God, by a desire to be kind, to do good, and to tend to others. from his infancy, I also recognized that despite medical predictions saying that Mattie would not survive and that he would not likely walk, talk, or think like typical children, well, it was clear to me and clear to many that my child was in fact quite resilient and very smart, as many children are. But as I mentioned in the previous session, it was also rather unsettling for me that beyond smart, my son also had this wisdom, this understanding that were truly beyond his years. And he also had a connection, a relationship, an actual friendship, I would dare say, with God. And yes, this was concerning to me. It wasn't frightening, but it was unsettling to me. It was something that for a very long time, I tried to keep incredibly private. And I kept it private because I did not want my son to be judged. I didn't want him judged by friends, community, school, teachers, and especially by doctors. I was afraid that doctors would say to me, oh, he's talking to God, about God. He must be close to death. And then they might give up hope. They might give up all the effort they were putting in to try to keep him going medically. I kept it private. I also encouraged my son to keep these matters private. I would say to him, wow, God speaks into your heart. That's beautiful. Let's just keep those messages in your heart. Let's talk about them just here at home. Mattie was a really good kid. He was a good listener, for the most part, quite well behaved, but he was not so inclined to keep what God was placing in his heart private as mommy asked him to do. Instead, he shared more and more these messages. He shared them in poetry and stories and psalms and prayers, then in speeches and in media appearances, and always in his everyday life, his conversations, interactions, his attention to others and to the world. Mattie really tried to never miss any opportunity to shape those God-inspired messages placed in his heart so that he could share them with as many people as possible, because he saw that as his job. He believed he was a faithful servant and a messenger. So he shared locally and globally. He shared one-on-one and he shared in classrooms. He shared with mega audiences who came to his book signings, people who tuned into all of his TV appearances. And he shared in these incredible ways so that children, adults, and teens, Christians, other faiths, and even non-believers, local, national, global leaders, lost folks, lonely for something in this world folks, he shared in a way that all people could hear God's message through Mattie's words. He wanted people to understand the important matters of love, acceptance, community, peace, purpose, play, faith, hope, gratitude, and so much more. You're going to hear from others tonight on Mattie's life and messages of hope and gratitude. And I'd go into those in detail if I had another gazillion hours. But what I'll say for tonight about hope and gratitude is, I think for Mattie, they were like many other virtues and truths that were simply a part of Mattie's choice to be a faithful servant, to not only share God's messages in word, but also live those messages in action during his life and even in his death. I will say this, Mattie needed hope his entire life. It is why he chose Jude Thaddeus as his confirmation name. Mattie also knew hope his entire life. He knew hope in seeing the beauty and the worth and the purpose of other people, even when there were differences or when life was challenging. He knew hope by embracing gratitude and in so many moments, even when there was so much grief in his life and in his world. He celebrated hope through his faith in being reverent and being prayerful by receiving the sacraments, especially the Eucharist. Mattie received the Eucharist as the body of Christ, not some symbol. He would often say to me, communion is God within us. It's a strength. It's our hope that we can receive again and again and again and again. And he was so excited when, as a little guy, he realized that the word Eucharist actually translates to something like thank you. He was like, this is like simple gratitude for this gift of hope. And as Mattie was suffering, and I mean suffering greatly during his final months, his final days, when his medical team would ask, what can we do for you? What do you need? What do you want? He would always respond with requests for them to comfort other children, saying to the babies, take care of his mother. His only final request for himself was for the sacraments of reconciliation and the Eucharist. This was his hope, even as he knew his body was about to die. I'm going to pause here so that we can watch a small excerpt of a video that played in the waiting room area during Mattie's wake and funeral. Larry King Live's team created this beautiful and lengthy video summary of the celebration of Mattie's life, and it played on this loop as people waited and waited and waited in line to say their goodbyes. What I'm going to share is the last 5 minutes of this video.
I'm certain. I am doubtful. I am desperate for solutions. I am leader. I am student. I am fate and evolution.
Tonight, remembering a remarkable young man, 13-year-old Jeni Stepanek, poet, peacemaker, inspiration, has lost his brave fight against an incurable disease. His words and spirit live on next on a very special Larry King Live.
I am you. I am also
Thanks for joining us. Every once in a while, life introduces you to somebody who helps put everything else into perspective. Someone who makes you realize that your problems are not such a big deal. Someone who makes you want to count your blessings and try to do your best every minute of every day. Jeni Stepanek was one of those rare somebodies, and he died early this morning. He would have been 14 years old next month. Jeni was an incredible kid, gifted and gutsy, and a very good friend of this program.
13-year-old Jeni Stepanek is being remembered today as a best-selling child poet who gave a voice to muscular dystrophy and inspired people everywhere. Jeni died Tuesday from a rare form of the disease, but as NBC's Bob Faw tells us now, he accomplished more in his short time on Earth than most do in a lifetime.
This is a tough one for all of us. It's a goodbye that we hoped would never come. Nearly 3 years ago, we introduced you to this unforgettable little fellow, Jeni Stepanek, and we were all so taken with him. He had such an infectious spirit and a rare gift for showing us, just how great life can be, even as he fought a terrible disease. And this morning, ABC's Chris Cuomo, who spent a lot of time with Jeni, is joining us to remember him.
He was in a hospital bed. He'd been in one for months. He was in the arms of his mother. They said he was feeling love. They said he was peaceful. And for those of you that didn't know this special little boy, that is the perfect way to describe him.
Don't believe the Christmas trees. Everything is so much more beautiful and wonderful and glorious than anything we can imagine or compare or create. Especially the light and the angels. The light is so many things. A window, a tunnel, a sunset at the edge of a polished pier. And the angels are more than just males and females with wings. They glow with the light of every color, one color at a time, or all at once, or none at all. But there is no darkness. There is no darkness in heaven, and there is no death. Even though we must die to enter, as we face the light and the angels, we are beyond any type of death. Don't believe the Christmas trees. Heaven is beyond human description. Believe in the spirit behind the trees. Believe in the life related to the decorations. Believe in the word leading us to our future. And always, and always, believe in the light and the angels.
Thank you.
hoping that by now Larry King is in heaven with Mattie and Katie Couric's here. But I'm hoping people have learned to say Stepanek instead of Stepanek. But I actually, I chose to share that particular clip of this particular video for a number of reasons. One, you get to see with all the little compilations, you know, all the different pictures, you get to see that this was a child who celebrates life with peace, with purpose, with play, and yet who also clearly suffers so many times, so much pain, so much loss. The other thing is that you get to hear his voice. When you hear his voice, it's a sound that still echoes that innocence of childhood and yet shapes words that resonate with the depth of insight and inspiration. And that inspiration for Mattie came from God. Mattie knew the Trinity in a very unique way. He knew the Holy Spirit as his strength, the source of those specific virtues, courage, wisdom, understanding, faith, hope, gratitude. All those gifts that he relied on in both the tough times and the best times of his life. Mattie knew Jesus, his Savior, as his brother, his role model. It was Jesus that Mattie looked to for the how of living a worthy and good life. How to teach, how to pray, how to live in community, how to seek and make and bring peace. And it was Jesus who was there with the angels each time Mattie almost left this world, but somehow was brought back. It was Jesus who Mattie turned to for spiritual and physical strength in the Eucharist, the body of Christ, when he was sick and suffering. But it was God. It was God whom Mattie heard in his heart. It was God who Mattie said created him, gave him life, and the gift of purpose. It was God who asked Mattie to be a messenger, shaping words from his heart, sharing them with all people so that all people could hear the important matters of living with love and purpose and in community as God created us to be and to do. So the insight, the words, those interactions, those were Mattie's choices, but the inspiration in his heart, in his life, that was God. The poem that you heard in the video I just shared, the one all about angels, the title of that poem is Awakening After a Close Call. Mattie was coming back to us after another near-death experience. This time it was late spring 2001. He was 10 years old. I had been warned that if he survived this latest insult on his body, if he even woke up yet again, there may well be significant damage to his brain. So when he opened his eyes in late spring and began with, don't believe the Christmas trees, well, of course, my first thought, my first concern was, oh dear, his brain's been impacted finally, okay? But as he continued talking about the light and what he was witnessing, all of us around his bed in the intensive care unit realized this was simply Mattie being Mattie, speaking again as this child who just seems to always have a foot planted in two homes, an earthly home and a heavenly home. In wrapping up my thoughts this evening, I want to offer one more excerpt from Mattie. This one is a poetic expression that he shared when he was just 3 years old. A few weeks before he shared what I'm about to offer you, he actually came to me hysterical. He was sobbing, crying, and saying that his brother Jamie was not in heaven. He said, when I died back into heaven, Jesus was there in the light with Katie and Stevie, but Jamie was not there. Why wouldn't Jesus let Jamie into heaven? And through his tears, he described how he was in this beautiful light with Jesus, with Katie, with Stevie, his brother and sister. And Jesus offered him right then and there the chance to go home to heaven, or the choice to go home to earth for a few more years. And Mattie said that the time that he would go back to earth would be filled with both suffering and joy, and that it would still end when he was young, but it would also be a time that would be filled with purpose that was to be given to him by God. Mattie was 3 years old when he's saying this to me, 3 years old. And he said, I looked at Jesus and I said, what would God ask of me? And he said that Jesus then, quote, threw me back into my body. And he said, my body was on a porch with gray peeling paint. And he began to describe all the things on the porch in great detail. And he said, and you were there, Mommy. You were kneeling over me. You were kissing me on the lips and you were rubbing my belly. And he said he didn't remember anything else except that Katie and Stevie were there in the light with Jesus, but not his brother, Jamie. I know this all sounds hard to believe. So perhaps you can step back and imagine a bit how hard it is for me as his mother to hear and understand these things. Back then, when he's 3 years old, I actually had to pause and sort out, what in the world are you talking about? What is it that you're referencing? But it was his vivid description, the detailed description of that porch. I realized he was referring to an incident that had occurred when he was 5 weeks of age and his heart had stopped. I was driving to church with him. The alarm on the monitor that he was hooked up to began beeping, warning that he had no heart rate and no respirations. I grabbed him and began doing CPR. Yes, outside on a porch with gray peeling paint and every other detail that he had shared. Not a porch he would ever see again. This is an incident I would never have shared with my preschool age child. And to my knowledge, no medical person had ever talked to this little boy about it. But I knew without doubt he was referring to the cardiac arrest when I did CPR on him for about 6 minutes, pushing on his heart, breathing into his mouth, until the paramedics arrived and his limp body suddenly arched, his heart started again, his eyes opened, and within an hour, it was like nothing had ever happened. There was no apparent post-cardiac arrest medical fallout. And honestly, it was only because this whole cardiac arrest, this whole 6 minutes of me doing CPR on him was recorded on this machine that the doctors could believe when they looked at him an hour later that he had really been gone for 6 minutes and that my CPR was the only thing keeping his body alive. They also could not understand with that level of trauma, not in a hospital setting, why there was no medical or brain damage trauma. Back then, when he's 3 years old, to calm him down, to reassure him that his brother Jamie was in fact in heaven, I decided I had to tell my three-year-old son the truth. And I said, Mattie, you're a very strong boy now. But when you were a little bitty baby, you were very weak. Your heart had some trouble, and I had to help you by breathing into your mouth and helping your heart work. You were on a side porch, but you did not die, and here you are today. But when this happened, I want you to remember, you were a little bitty baby, and your brother Jamie was still alive. Katie and Stevie had already died. They were in heaven. But Jamie was still here on earth with you and with me. Yes, this all happened. And this, like so many other experiences with Mattie, other times, other things, these are truths that are hard for me to understand. But I have to believe that yes, my son has a foot in two homes. A few weeks after this conversation, Mattie came to me and asked if he could share a very special message that God had placed in his heart. I'm going to share two excerpts from that message. The first is just a statement of relief that Jamie's in heaven. And the second is a statement of Mattie's realization of his purpose. And he said, Dear God, thank you for sharing into my heart, Jamie, and that Katie and Stevie are with our Jesus. This gives me peace. He goes on to share a bit about how God gives him hope and how he's grateful for life and purpose, including this phrase, thank you for sharing into my heart so many messages that I am now sharing out from my heart with the gifts of the words that you let my mind feel and that I let my hands and mouth and life shape for our world. This gives me purpose. Mattie came into this world and Mattie lived in this world and Mattie left this world ever a faithful servant. And his legacy, his essence, those universal and timeless messages that God placed in his heart and that Mattie shaped with his words and his life, they continue to echo and resonate in this world as truths that can inspire each of us to embrace hope and gratitude and to be a faithful servant for good. Who is Mattie? A faithful servant. And that's a truth we can each choose to be. So thank you very much. And I will pass this on to the next person. We're back to Kathy.
Thank you, Jenny. Yes, thank you very much. And now we're ready to hear from Cheryl Kerwin. Cheryl, you're muted.
I thought somebody was going to unmute me. Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm very pleased to be with you and discussing embracing the cross for the second talk in this series. Some of you are probably thinking, wow, is she really going to talk about the cross? We just came through Lent, Stations of the Cross, Good Friday, etc., etc. I get that. But we are Easter people, aren't we? Christians believe that the resurrection of Jesus shows that disappointment, suffering, even suffering unto death, can be transformed into new life. But folks, we can't avoid the cross. We must go through the cross to get to that new life, that resurrection, if you will. Sometimes knowing Jesus better involves knowing ourselves or others just a little bit better first. We are so used to the tangible, the touchable, and it makes it difficult to wrap our heads around Jesus, whom we never knew in the flesh. And that's where I'm coming from this evening. We would do well to look at Jesus people that we admire, along with Jesus himself. What is it about them that makes us see Jesus in them, or see Jesus reflected through them? I want to share with you a small piece of Mattie's life of virtue, his unwavering faith in God, and how he inspired others in their own faith walk. He demonstrated how a young boy can come through pain, adversity, and the fragility of life with joy and hope and fear and for the future. Mattie was and is a Jesus person. Christ goes to the cross and he offers his very life up for our sins, the expiation of our sins. Then the tie-in came to me of Mattie being an excellent example of a person who used his suffering for others. He comforted other children in the PICU, bought them toys and games to distract them from their terrible problems. He was focused on the needs of others in every situation, regardless of his own medical frailty. A lighthearted example of Mattie's concern and generosity was when I took two of my young granddaughters trick-or-treating with him. Brenna was only about 3 and Mattie perhaps 7, and he seemed concerned that she wasn't getting enough treats, so he started putting some of his candy into her bucket. He was selfless and always a champion of the underdog, even though many would have called him the underdog. Jesus people, that was Mattie. So yes, let's talk about Mattie and the cross. Jesus is condemned to death. Why? He wasn't a troublemaker. He wasn't an evil person. He never harmed anyone. But the authorities were afraid of him. Even some of his own people, the Jews, were afraid of him or disappointed in him. This was no ruler, no king. What about us? Aren't many of us condemned to a life not of our own making due to a life-threatening disease, a chronic illness that makes us want to die? An accident or illness that has left us wheelchair bound or in constant pain. And Mattie, he was condemned to death from the day he was born. Yet he and his family and friends looked on each day as a gift. His devout faith allowed him to understand, even at an early age, that to embrace suffering, to embrace the cross as Jesus did, is to discover that life stretches beyond the limits that this world sets. Here I'd like to share a scripture verse from Isaiah that haunts me about my own life as well as Mattie's. He was a bruised reed, but he did not break. Jesus carries the cross. Because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Jesus never forgot why he was born and the heavy burden of the cross. If we are true servants of the Lord, we must expect to experience suffering and struggle, just as Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane, and then when he accepted the cross on the way to Calvary. Mattie was such a person too. He was wise beyond his years and understood what it meant to follow the Lord. He chose not to be defeated by his challenges and instead turned his face to God, responding to the purpose God gave him. His heart song, his purpose, included dealing with his infirmities in a joyful, non-judgmental way, that is, not blaming God. And he conveyed that every day through his talk, his poetry, and simply his actions. At one point in Mattie's very young life, he and his mother were living in the basement of some friends, and I would visit them there. If it was an evening and Mattie was completing his bedtime ritual, I would watch as he and Jeni plugged in machines, untangled wires, took medications, and put his oxygen mask on, all in a very synchronized manner. Mattie did this every single night, and all with very little to no complaining. I never personally heard him whine or complain about the ritual. The most I can say is that he begged for a little more time to stay up and read an extra story or hear Jeni talk to him. I had 4 or 5 grandchildren by this time, and I can tell you that getting one swallow of a medicine down was a superhuman feat for me. Jesus falls for the first time. How awful. Jesus was a humble man and again didn't ask for or deserve any of this appalling misery that he was now experiencing. We fall in our personal lives, also as a community and even as a nation. But as followers of Jesus, we must follow his example and get up and continue. Fourth word, that's a word that Mattie coined, and I'm sure it represents the many falls he encountered. But like Jesus, he got back up and continued the journey. Simon helps Jesus carry the cross. Even Jesus needed help and wasn't too proud to accept it. Are we Simon to others in our life? Who have we helped today, whether bidden or unbidden? Mattie was Simon to so many people. He lifted their spirits, offered to carry their crosses through his talks, his reflections, and his poetry. He shared his conversations with God and is still influencing people to think about faith, hope, love, peace, kindness, and purpose. Jesus is nailed to the cross. Crosses come in many forms. Just as in Jesus's time, he and we are threatened with financial burdens, illness, both mental and physical, food insecurity, job insecurity, the loss of a loved one. Crosses are a part of our human experiences. Jesus didn't give up on the good thief, Dismas, who was nailed to the cross beside him, and he doesn't give up on us either. Can we take someone down from their cross today? Can we show them love instead of hate? Mattie knew very well that God never gives up on us. His poems speak of hope repeatedly. He most certainly wanted very much to live, but he wasn't afraid of dying. Mattie knew what it meant to be a suffering servant, to experience near death, struggles, grief, and anguish, but to let God direct his desires and actions. Jesus's body is placed in the tomb. We know that Christ wins the day. Darkness ends. Jesus said yes to his Father, God, and now we'll live forever and ever in glory with him. What about us? Do we truly believe that the darkness will end? I have a friend who thinks about ending her life every single day, and the suicidal ideations have been going on for more than 15 years. She is a fellow Catholic, and I feel as though she hasn't taken her own life simply because she is Catholic and believes that God loves her. But what a tremendous burden to bear, and very tough for friends and family, people like me, who feel helpless as she struggles. Mattie lived on the edge between two worlds, something difficult to comprehend for those of us not living with an incurable condition. He too knew that Christ wins the day. Darkness ends. At the end of his life, his final word was yes. Based on what I knew of his life, I choose to think that this was a surrendering to his Lord, his Savior. Can we say yes with confidence? I believe that many of you on this call never met Mattie, but may have been changed by his life of joy, peace, and indomitable spirit. Our next speakers for tonight's program are both incredible witnesses to Mattie's influence on those who didn't know him personally. In closing, I'd like to quote a couple lines from my pastor, Father Martino Choi's homily of Sunday, March 17th, because it so impressed me as a Mattie moment. Losing this world is necessary to get to the next one. The bad news is that we have crosses. The good news is that Jesus is right there with you. Peace.
Thank you, Cheryl. That was wonderful. Jeni, now let's listen to Mattie read his poem on being thankful, which actually is a personal favorite of mine. And he wrote this when he was 5.
Get full screen up here.
On being thankful. Dear God, I was going to thank you tonight for a beautiful sunrise, that was pink behind the fog down the hill, and for a wonderful rainbow that I ran under, pointing to all my favorite colors, and for such a great sunset that sparkled orange across the lawn. I was going to thank you tonight for all these special gifts, except that none of them happened. But do you know what? I still love you, God, and I have lots of other things that I can thank you for tonight, even if you didn't give those very special gifts to me today. It's okay, God, because I'll look for them all again when my tomorrow comes. Amen. November 1995.
It's okay, God. So next, we welcome Johnny Sai.
Well, we're going to take you back to the year 2000, to a little snapshot of time when I saw Maddie and his mom, Jeni, come around the corner and into my aisle, where I sat in my own wheelchair, selling my biblically correct t-shirts and my Cloud of Witness poetry books as a vendor at the Washington, D.C.'s Eucharistic Congress. A tiny but profound moment forever etched into my heart. Taking a second from my own pain and looking over to see a young woman and her young son, both in wheelchairs, electric wheelchairs, talking and rolling into my view. Instantly, I saw a mother ignoring her own issues to tend to her son, who too was obviously uncomfortable. And he tried, yet both just kept plugging and plugging along. He was tired, but they both, you could just tell, kept coming and doing what they felt they were to do. And it was to bring joy to others. Maddie might have thought that his purpose was to bring peace and share his heart song and help others find theirs. But in that instance of seeing him roll around that corner, his purpose was to show me and others the image of Christ crucified, giving himself for others. And that's what Maddie did. That's what I will always remember, is that he, you know, we know of Saint Maximilian Kolbe is a man for others. Well, Maddie was a young man for others. It was a profound moment for me that I'll never forget. And it took me outside of myself. When you deal with pain every day and body falling apart, it's easy to get wrapped up into ourselves. I mean, I lived that, and I was fighting every day that selfishness. And seeing Maddie tired and his mom catering to him, giving him strength just by loving him, Maddie made me realize there's more than, it took me out of my own pain. And I'll never forget that. And also just the joy that he showed, like, you know, just seeing them come around the corner. And then when they came up to my booth, Jeni, you probably don't even remember this, but he brought me joy and gave me hope. So I might not have known him like Cheryl, like Jeni, like others, but the moment I laid eyes on him, he was showing me the crucified Christ in his body, but also the risen Christ of the hope of a healthy body in heaven. Maddie wasn't locked into himself. He's the image of a true saint, is what I saw, that he was there for God and there for others. And that's why I'm, you know, here today, is to say how this little boy in this chance meeting touched my heart so. And then reading his poetry later in life, after he had already had passed, it was just something else that connected me to Maddie, is the poetry and the art. Maybe he didn't draw or paint like I do, but the poems we both shared, and he was a child, but his childlike acceptance and his childlike vision and how he saw things is something that I hope I will always carry within me. I'd like to illustrate like some of his words from the poems. And I feel like, oh, I must have the mind of a 13-year-old boy. Well, if the 13-year-old boy is Mattie, then I'm okay with that. but just his witness, even in struggling, is more than words can say. His love for others, his smile for others. You know, purpose, yes, is to, for peace, for joy. But Mattie's purpose was to bring God, Christ, to others in the world. He made Christ accessible. He made Christ's love accessible to us. And one of the things why I think that Mattie touched my heart so back then and still does today, is I just want to read one of our other suffering saints, John Paul the Great, in his encyclical on human suffering. He wrote, and I love this quote, "People who suffer become similar to one another through the analogy of their situation, the trial of their destiny, or through their need for understanding and care. And perhaps above all, through the persistent question of the meaning of suffering. Thus, although the world of suffering exists in dispersion, at the same time, it contains within itself a singular challenge to communion and solidarity." Mattie had a way, and again, it was just that moment of making me realize I'm not alone in my suffering. He obviously knew that he wasn't alone in his. He had his lovely mother there, but he also had his heavenly father and his brother Jesus. He knew God. And to be able to know that you're not alone in your suffering, because sometimes you just feel like nobody understands. But Mattie did. And he pointed to Jesus, who understands what we're going through in our suffering. So I'm grateful for that moment and didn't expect it would, you know, just waiting around for people to come to my booth. And then I see Jeni and Mattie come around the corner, and it was literally life-changing for me. And it continues to be. And my dad always, God rest his soul, he would always tell me, even growing up when I wasn't ill, that came later in my life at 30 or in the early 30s, he always said, you have to count your blessings because there are others that have it so much worse than you do. And I really took that to heart. And even in Mattie's suffering, you could just tell by his giving of himself that he knew other people suffered and that it could be worse. He had a loving mother. He had friends. He had family, church family. But above all, he had Jesus. He wasn't alone. And that being alone in our sufferings wouldn't be so much worse. And so, like my dad said, to count my blessings is that I have Jesus. I have family. I have friends. I have the Blessed Mother. That she's my mother at times, you know. I can count my blessings through my difficulties, my challenges, my pain. And Mattie gives me strength to see this. I just remember that picture of him, seeing him coming down that aisle. And he gives me strength because of his joy and his love for God. And I know Mattie struggled, and I didn't see that. You know, Jeni sees it all the time. Cheryl sees it, you know, and you guys lived with that. But I could tell that he was struggling, and he was very tired. But there was a beauty about Mattie. Like, I'm in our little chapel here, and I'm looking at the cross, and I'm looking at the crucified Christ. It's not pretty. Jesus, as Cheryl talked about, you know, he was crucified. He was beaten. He didn't deserve any of that. And then looking at the cross, not a pretty sight, but absolutely beautiful. It's the beauty of love. And that's what I saw in Mattie, his love for his mom, his love for those that would wanted to talk to him. And I did understand. I mean, I remember just being there going, oh, I just couldn't wait till I got home. I was exhausted. And here's this little boy that you could see the exhaustion on him. And he was full of energy and wanted to bring people to Christ. He wanted to, whether it put the little heart song or what he would write in their hands, he wanted to give others the joy that he got from God. And for that, I will always be grateful for my moment with Mattie.
Thank you, Jeni. Thank you very much. And now we welcome the Guild's spiritual advisor, Father Chris Tsai.
Thanks so much, Kathy. Good to hear from you, Mom. Thanks for that. I'll start just by commenting. One of the fun things that struck me, Mom, was just, one of the beautiful things was just highlighting, right? So something Jesus said was, not as the world gives, do I give peace to you, right? Peace I give you, my peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, do I leave with you. And there was something that Mattie communicated in his peacemaking mission, which he really saw, like this is, you know, what he wanted to do, but it was such an otherworldly peace that he was communicating, which is so beautiful. I just want to talk about hope and in a way that I think Mattie would appreciate. So I looked up one of my favorite questions that St. Thomas Aquinas asks. He says, does hope abound in youth and in people who are drunk? and he ultimately answers, like, in a certain sense, yes, because of what hope is. He says hope is the pursuit of a future difficult but possible good. The person who hopes is pursuing a good that's in the future. It's difficult to attain, but it is possible. And so he says that someone who's young looks at goods that are future because they have so little of life behind them and so much of life ahead of them. And so looking at so much life ahead, there's this certain natural hope that young people have. Incidentally, you can also say that people that are drunk have this same hope because their memory is quite short. And so they also look ahead at what is in front of them, at what is future. So how does Mattie fit into this? Because obviously he knew from a young age that his future was not going to be long, that he didn't have a long future ahead of him. And this is where really the supernatural virtue of hope comes in. Mattie was living for heaven. There's just no question about it. He knew that that's where he was headed. And yet looking towards heaven didn't distract him from how beautiful this earth could be. It actually helped him appreciate it even more because this earth is supposed to be a reflection of heaven. And so he spent his life trying to make earth reflect heaven so that people know what to expect. When he was getting ready for death, I remember him reading the story of just him talking about like he's going to be sad when he leaves this earth because there's so many wonderful things. But what awaits him is even more wonderful. And so the future that Mattie had was so much longer than people who live without the supernatural virtue of hope, and they're just trying to hold on to this world. And that we just try to get all the good out of this world that we can. And it actually makes us old and like overly sober about life because we don't have that future that we have to look forward to. The other thing, okay, so future difficult, but difficult but possible, right? So first of all, difficult, that the person who is young, the young person wants to go after difficult things. They're not satisfied with just, you know, kind of simple challenges. They want what's really difficult, right? You put a challenge before a young person, like, I bet you can't, you know, climb up that mountain. They're like, okay, done. You know, I'm going to do it. You know, this is why, like, daring someone who's young to do something always works. He's like, I dare you to do this because I bet you won't, you know? And they're like, oh, I'm going to do it. You know, the young person that is very spirited, going after the difficult good. Again, the drunk person also goes after difficult things, like, oh yeah, you know, the famous hold my beer and watch this, right? So so this hope that we see in this, okay, well, so how does the supernatural virtue of hope look, right? The person with the supernatural virtue of hope wants something very good and very difficult, which is to resemble God. We just heard about what that means, the sacrificing nature of what resembling God looks like and the immensity of his love. That's difficult, living in that hope, pursuing that good. But the person with the supernatural virtue of hope says, yes, like, that is beautiful, and I want to be united to it, and so united to it that that's what I look like. And Mattie had this. He wanted to reflect the love of God that he was experiencing for others. I mean, we see this in so many beautiful ways. Like we heard, right, when he was in the hospital, and he's just concerned about all the other kids that are there, you know, take care of them, take care of my mom. I mean, it's the last thing that Jesus did before he dies, right, is to take care of his mom, you know, giving her to John. And Mattie just wanting to resemble that and that difficult good that he wasn't afraid of embracing. And so just the man of hope that that Mattie was. And then finally, that it's a difficult good, but that the hopeful person sees it as something possible. That even though it's difficult, you know, I can do that. I think I can do that. The young person hasn't had a lot of experience of failure, and so he thinks he can do anything. You know, there's no way that anything wrong is going to happen to me. I'm just going to thrive in everything I do. And so he's very hopeful. The drunk person, not worried about failing, doesn't think it's possible. You know, he's just, of course I can do this. Like, this is not a problem. Mattie had a lot of reasons to think that it wouldn't be possible. He was confronted at a very early age with his limitedness, with what he could not do, seemingly. And so we see in him this supernatural virtue of hope that is looking at someone other than himself for a source of accomplishment. The reason that he thought that he could do this, that he could live this way, is because he was convinced of God's power at work within him, and that's it. And also God's power at work within other people. The fact that Mattie was a messenger of peace in our world, like, there's no reason to think that that's going to work, except that Mattie was confident in the one that sent him on that mission, and in his power to change people's hearts. I'm reminded of the great story of the car that was in the race, and Jeni, you can correct the details of this, but I remember, I think it was maybe the owner, right, of this car that was, like, possibly going to win, and somebody whose car had no chance of winning caused the crash, and so he wasn't able, I think it was Rob was his name, right?
Ron Hemmelgarn.
Ron. And so, of course, you know, the crash caused, you know, Ron's car to not win, be able to win. And Ron was not happy. And Mattie was like, well, I need to talk to Ron because, like, you know, there's other things to live for. Like, and everybody else was like, whoa, not the time. There's no way you're going to get through to him. And Mattie just was unfazed. He gave it 10 minutes and then said, okay, like I have to talk to Ron. He was just so confident in God's capacity to touch people's hearts and to give them peace, to bring them back to peace, to let them know love, to bring them back to the awareness of who they truly are in God's eyes, their dignity. And again, so we see in Mattie just this young man who was filled with the supernatural virtue of hope, looking forward to a home, a future home that is eternal, that's difficult to attain, to radiate in his own being the beauty and the love of God. But that's still possible because he's not looking at himself for strength. It's one of Mattie's greatest strengths, is his capacity to receive others' strength. He didn't look to himself. He looked to others. He looked to God. And that receptivity to others' love and others' presence in his life is what allowed him to communicate that love and that strength to others. And so Mattie is just a beautiful witness to the supernatural virtue of hope.
Unmute.
You're muted there, Kathy.
I think you want me to share my screen
again. Jeni, I was saying before we open it up for questions, maybe we can now listen to Mattie, yes, recite Psalm of Tad 358.
Okay. And this is a poem that Mattie wrote. This is a psalm that Mattie wrote just a couple of weeks before he slipped into a coma that lasted months, that we really didn't think he was going to survive. Just a few weeks later, nobody thought he was going to survive. But this was how he went into this crash.
Psalm of Tad, 358. Lord, you have saved me from sadness and lifted me to light. All my life, I have been haunted by the darkness. Only my dreams gave me sight. But my Savior has now turned me back to light. No longer do I dwell in shadows. Lord, you have saved me from sadness and lifted me to light. Lord, you comfort me in your gentle arms. You dry tears of sadness from my eyes. My God, I forever await you in hope. From the ashes of Job, I arise. Lord, you have saved me from sadness and lifted me to light. Now I know I have no fear, for I am being watched by guardians above. The darkness can no longer sadden me, for I am shrouded in my Savior's love. Lord, you have saved me from sadness and lifted me to light. February 2001.
And I'll just note that Tad was what he was going to name his first child, Matthew Joseph Thaddeus Stepanek Jr., and call him Tad. So this was his hope from his confirmation name.
So we don't need that yet.
Okay. And we'll stop sharing.
All right. Okay. So now we're ready to begin the Q&A portion of the evening. And first, thank you to all the panelists for sharing your stories. And to our participants, if you have questions for the speakers, put them in the chat. We'll then call on you and you'll be unmuted at this point, so that you'll go ahead and be able to ask your question. Or if there's a story about Mattie that you'd like to share, please let us know. So I think, again, everyone should be unmuted. And let's look at the chat. Lorene, I believe we have a question for Jeni from Beth or Bethy.
Yes, we do. She was asking how Jeni suggests we use our suffering for others. And, you know, including Mattie as the example for that?
Great question. It's kind of my spiel.
Yeah, you don't know what you just opened up.
Yeah. So our sufferings by themselves, our pain, our worries, our anxieties, they don't do anything, right? Except make us crazy. But when we give them to God, and we hear this line about offering it up, but it really is you saying, God, I will accept the suffering. And I'm giving it to you. I want to unite it with your sufferings. Because without God, it does nothing. But giving him our okay, giving him our pain, asking him to take it and to unite it to his suffering, he can do everything with it. And so it can become a way of life. I think Mattie had that. I know I've tried I've been sick for like 30 years now. And pain is hard. And we all have different pain, whether it's emotional or physical every kind. We can't even imagine what people are going through. But it's a prayer power when you unite it with Christ, because he can do everything with it. And I'll just give an example from my own life. I would be, when Father Chris was in Rome for 5 years, I didn't get to talk to him that much. And he was busy with studies and everything. And I remember him calling me one day and saying, how you doing? I'm like, oh man, I had a really bad day. He goes, I thought so, because I had a great day. Were you offering it up for me? And I'm like, yes. But it's real. It's also that selflessness. I'll accept my crosses. Mattie accepted his crosses. Didn't mean that they were great and that he liked them all the time, but that acceptance and asking God to do something with that, that only he can do, gives life and grace to others. It's real. It's us crawling up on that cross with him and seeing Mattie. He was already crawled up on that cross with Christ. And you could just, Christ was holding Mattie. And Mattie knew it. Mattie knew he couldn't do anything without God. And so that uniting is what gives grace through God to others. Did that answer the question?
I'm just going to, Mom let me, she said, if I ever say anything and, you know, I need to interpret Mom, I can do that. So I'm going to do that real quick. No, one of the beautiful things I think, Mom, that you're, tell me if this is right. And Jeni, you can speak to Maddie's experience too, but when it's offered up, right, it's, when you say that, what ends up happening is that the suffering is joined to love. And so it actually becomes a place of union with other people's brokenness that we're usually running away from. And we don't want to address that I'm broken and I've got problems, all these different things. And then when I see someone who has let their suffering become a place of union with another by offering themselves to another in love, through the midst of suffering, becomes sacrifice. It opens up in our hearts a greater capacity to love. I know, like reading Messenger, that's what Mattie did for me, just seeing him suffer so beautifully opened up my heart. So I would just say that the capacity to open hearts is maybe another way of looking at it.
That's what I meant. Thank you, Chris. It's a way. I remember one time I was in so much pain and I could not remember who I wanted to pray for. And as I'm just, you know, laying there and praying, it came to my mind who the prayers were for. And my first thought was thanking God for reminding me who I was praying for, but saying, thank you for letting me love this person in this way. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah, that's beautiful. We do have another question, and this one might be directed towards Jeni. Did Mattie have any other saints that inspired him?
Yes, he did. And who did that question come from?
It says an iPhone, so I don't have a name. I apologize.
I want to address them. Before I answer that, I just wanted to say one of the things that Mattie said, which fits with what Jeni and Father Chris are saying. On the day that Mattie found out, he was 10 years old. It was right after he did Don't Believe the Christmas Trees. He literally came out of a coma, woke up to find out you're going to die. There's nothing else we can do. And you might have 3 days, you might have 3 weeks. You do not have 3 months. Technically, he had exactly 3 years to the day, okay? But his child life specialist asked him, because he was in great pain, great, great pain, and emotional pain and physical pain. And his child life specialist asked him what was his first thought, because and Mattie's response was, if I have enough breath to complain about anything, I have more than enough reason to give thanks about something.
Mm-hmm.
And he was just happy that he was there to continue inspiring other people until his time for death came. And he said, I will live until death comes rather than spend the rest of my life dying. So I just wanted to add that. Did Mattie have other saints that inspired him? Absolutely. So St. Jude Thaddeus, he took that as his confirmation name because his brother had been confirmed as a very young little guy because he was dying. He didn't study for it, but it was a sacrament given to him. And I took for his brother the name Jude. Mattie wanted to be so connected to his brother. I mean, he just adored Jamie. Jamie was his best friend in the world, which is why he was hysterical when he thought Jamie's not in heaven and Katie and Stevie are there. What's wrong with Jamie? And he wanted to take Thaddeus, but there was no Saint Thaddeus, so he had to take Jude Thaddeus, but he kind of focused on the Thaddeus. And it meant loving and friendly. And Mattie said, Jude Thaddeus is the patron saint of hopeless situations. And he said, my life looks hopeless, but I want to remind people of the flip side of St. Jude, which is the patron saint of hopeful situations, not hopeless. Other saints that inspired Mattie, I'll just name two of them. One of them is St. Anthony. Oh, St. Anthony, please come round. Something's been lost and it must be found. Mattie referred to St. Anthony as Tony. Okay. They were like this. And right after what Father Chris had just said, This guy, Ron Hemelbarn, car 91, gets crashed into a wall in the final five laps. He's in the top five cars. They won the Indy 2 years earlier. They're going to try to win it again this year. And this car that's three laps down runs him into a wall. And Ron, I thought he was going to have a stroke. Mattie was like, no, we're just going to go for root beer sundaes. We're all going to be okay. So Mattie gets him calmed down. And then the next day, his whole family, they're out gazillions of dollars. It's not cheap to race these cars. And they're getting ready to leave. Most of the family has left Indianapolis and gone back to their home in Michigan. And the only two that were left were Ron and his wife, Helen. And they stayed behind because they had invited Mattie and I to be their guests. So they didn't want to pack up and leave in their misery before it was time for us to leave. And right as Ron and Helen got ready to leave, they realized we can't find the keys to the truck. And what they realized was that their son, they have five adult children, their son had driven all the way back to Michigan with the keys in his pocket to the truck. Now they've just lost their car, they've lost the race, they've lost their money, everything's miserable. And at this point, Ron was like, I am done. I literally am done. He was becoming hopeless. And Mattie was like, hold up. And he said, give me just a minute. I'll find the keys. Cause they can't find him. They can't reach Brent on the phone because he's driving someplace. And Mattie talked to St. Anthony and came back and said, nobody has to worry. The keys are in room. And he said, I don't know. I'm going to make it up. Room 107. And Ron says, Mattie, they checked out of room 107 yesterday. It's been cleaned by now. Somebody else is in it. And Maddie's like, no. It's under an orange blanket by the window, room 107. Go ask the people that they didn't clean the room. It's all good. And they're like, no, Mattie. And so finally, long story short, they go up and they said, I know this is crazy, but is there any way we can get into that room and just did anybody that checked in, you know, turn in our keys or anything? And they said, oh, we forgot to clean that room this morning. They went in. Mattie, this is not a wheelchair accessible room. His wheelchair does not fit through the door. Okay. It's too narrow. On the other side of the beds by the window, there was an orange blanket on the floor, and under the blanket were Ron's keys to the truck. So yes, St. Anthony was really close to Mattie. And the other one that I will mention is Blessed Brother Andre, who's now Saint Blessed Brother Andre. But back when he was blessed, and Mattie had come out of this, don't believe the Christmas trees, second coma in third coma in that year. And they said, you're not going to survive. And he spent the next 6 weeks in the hospital, profusely bleeding from his trachea. And just everybody knowing at any moment, he's going to cough, sneeze, even laugh, even laughter could cause him to die. And Mattie was a child that laughed all the time, but he was told, like, don't laugh, don't sneeze, don't cough, don't talk. That's kind of like saying to a tree, don't grow your leaves. Okay. It's like not going to happen. And he decided he wanted to go home from the hospital after 6 weeks of just bleeding and waiting to die. And he said, I can't live in the hospital. Please let me go home. So it took like 2 weeks for them to figure out how to safely get him home. They didn't think he was even going to survive the ambulance ride from the hospital to our home. And the day before he was scheduled to leave by paramedics, they were going to come and take him home like that. Somebody had brought him a relic of Andre Bessette, who at the time had, I guess, one miracle towards sainthood, needed a second miracle. This is now August of 2001. And Mattie picked it up, and he basically, what I heard was, you need a miracle to become a saint. I need a miracle to finish my purpose. And I have something else left to do. I have little more time. Please let's work together. Like let's help each other out. And he touched the relic to his trachea that, like, you can look at photos. There's nothing but blood pouring out of this child for months and months, blood transfusions every day. And the bleeding stopped. The bleeding stopped. And Mattie closed his eyes, said a prayer. I have no clue what he said. But then he put the relic back on his little rolling tray in the hospital. And he said, now I'm ready to go home and finish God's purpose. And the doctors came over, and the doctors, of course, were panicked because their thought was it has now scabbed over, which was their biggest fear. Because they knew as soon as it scabbed over, the trachea was going to perforate and he's going to suffer and die across a 20-minute period. And they said, he can't go home tomorrow because he's like, when this happens, you have no pain medication at home for him. And Mattie was like, no, I just got a miracle. And the doctors did not believe it. They just thought this was the worst case scenario. And he went home and lived another couple of years. And when the bleeding started back up again, we all knew this was it. He was very close to a lot of saints, but those two are two of my favorite stories. So thank you for that question, iPhone.
That's great. Thank you, Jeni. And actually, I think now is a good time. We have a couple minutes for some closing comments and a prayer. So one thing that we would like to say to everyone listening is, if you've received a favor or a grace through Mattie's intercession, no matter how large or small, or if you feel it's insignificant, but something that you believe Mattie interceded for you, then contact us. Email us at info@mattiematters.org. Or if you have any stories that you'd like to share about Mattie, I think there were at least one or two who were here on the chat and we didn't get to you. So do share those with us. And then next session, we will definitely put you at the top if you're able to join us again. And because we'd like you to be able to share your stories. So that is something important that we'd like to hear from you. And we also just want to remind you of the upcoming events that we have. Jeni, we can share that screen for a second before we then go into a prayer. just to remember that we have the fundraiser on the 21st, the mass on the 22nd, which we would love everybody to be able to attend. We have Monsignor Ensler, who is going to be the celebrant and homilist. And again, it will be live streamed for those who aren't in town. Don't forget about the next virtue online that session that we have, which is on May 7th at 7 to 9 p.m. And any prayers that you have, we welcome those. You can go to our website where there's a prayer intentions basket. You can offer your prayers there, and we will then bring up all the prayers with the gifts at the Memorial Mass, and there will be a blessing for your prayers. So now let's just take another final moment to gather ourselves in prayer. And this is again taken from the St. Joseph Oratory in Montreal, which was founded by St. Andre. And this is an excerpt from Jesus, I Give You My Heart by Mother Julian du Rosaire. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus, I give you my heart, so that you may replace it with your heart, and so that I may thus love God, our Father, as you do. Love my brothers and sisters as you do. May it be no longer I who live, but rather you. I who pray, I who adore, but rather you. May it be no longer I who work, but rather you. I who suffer, rather you. May it be no longer I who love, but rather you. May my life be an incessant prayer of praise, of adoration, and of love to God our Father, through a sincere yes to his will at every moment. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So thank you, everyone. We'll see you on Tuesday, May 7 at 7 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, right back here on Zoom. And we'll send out a link that morning. Thank you so much. Good night.